So when we say, yes, we've got our IT strategy, we've got our design principles, we're going to rationalise, we're going to put stuff in the cloud, we're going to improve the experience of people, and therefore going to make savings, have we aggregated those savings? Do we know how much those savings are going to be? Yes. Has there been a business case wrapped around any of this yet? I suppose I should be asking Nicky this, but your ear is asking you and shares here as well.
In terms of identifying benefits, we have been able to do that in most cases at a high level. We are working, we have a digital program manager now in place who supports us in identifying those benefits at a much more granular level and identifying where capacity will be created within the organization. Digitalization. Clearly, that deals with things like customer access solution, which is 26,000 signups now, and that in time. Rationalisation, which Pete talked about, that obviously creates financial benefits with regards to contracts, but also in terms of the infrastructure which Pete maintains and supports those applications. So we're pulling that together, and it's perhaps an opportunity in the new system to bring that programme through the most appropriate committee for view and assurance in the future.
Okay, well, that's good that we are looking at that, because I think there are significant other organisations who are making lots of savings. Apparently, storage is as cheap as it's ever going to be or likely to be. So there are huge opportunities here. It would be useful, I think, I don't know if anybody already knew all this, but it would certainly be useful to see that whole digital programme. So what are we doing in the IT sphere in terms of what are these projects that are being signed off? What are they supposed to deliver? And also, you'll forgive me if we think back to the other 55, not just the last programme, but the programme before that as well, 55 million. If I didn't highlight the fact we need to have a strong focus on benefits realisation. So again, all these reports that are coming back at some point, it will be useful to have an report around our approach to benefits realisation and how do we make sure we've got the benefits, that we drive those benefits into the business, coupled to the change management and new processes and so on. Sorry. Yeah, Stuart.
So, we're already using that for Office 365, which obviously runs all our emails, and we've obviously got one drive now for which don't know how that's all the database. And cloud storage, it's going to be regulated and approved by the companies, because you can't just use any, well, you can't use any air cloud provider. No, there's the type of data we hold, and plus, like, you don't want to put all the eggs in one basket, because, you know, you can see instances where the companies offer some of these services, they go bust, and then you're beholden to them, or your data's, tied up in the cloud, so we potentially might not be able to access it. So, you know, I think it's a safety first approach when you're talking about the data we hold, and obviously, you know, business continuity is a big consideration.
Yeah, I wouldn't disagree with that at all. There's some big players like Amazon Cloud Services, that is the other issue, as I'm sure you're about to say, Stuart, was how to make sure you have the right interfaces in order to put stuff in the cloud and get it back out and so on. And I've seen people start down a particular area with their architecture that isn't right, so you'll never get to interface in the cloud, because you need, and Amazon have meant to be very good at providing the tools for that to happen. So there are lots of
providers who use suppliers to pay tax.
Okay, moving along. I was just going to close it down, Phil, but if you want to make a contribution.
I'll do my best, because it's an area that I have very little knowledge about. So was at Lincoln 30-odd years ago. I remember the lawyer who was a council for Greensbury. In those days, somebody from ICL came along and told us about the great benefits that would be brought in if we had some new computer applications. This is going back to Plan App, Soskis, and all sorts of wonderful things that probably died a quarter of a century ago. Reading some reports, I've come across suggestions that some of the programs we use, like Oracle, pass the date at which the companies are interested in maintaining them. So what I'm interested in is the problems I've found. I try and explain to members easily. When I've asked some of our dedicated officers, like Mr. Molyneux, for information about how leisure centres are performing budget-wise, there isn't an easy way for officers to dig into things and actually tell management tools how well things are going without powers of work, as I understand it. Mr. Molyneux at the back could probably be right if I'm wrong. But, you know, with determined effort, officers can extract data if it takes ages to do it. Now, the contrast, I think, is when I was on the improvement board for children's services and there was a mass investment in liquid logic. Then what I saw in operation in offices was, here's the file on the case, I can pull it up, I can see what the social workers are writing. There's a world of difference between some of the stuff we have and some of the stuff that is creaking and groaning along since whatever it was, 10, 15 years ago. So if our office can assure us that all these things are going to be solved, and it's going to be easy to get management information and easier to tell members what they want to know and to acquaint us with how things are going in practice, then I can be more assured, which I think may have assurance.
Well, rather than, and then there's a very easy answer to this that you go through in some detail about one of the systems, but rather than talk about individual systems, can I give you some assurance, Phil, that I know there is some work going on around that. But I think to pick up on Tim and Pete's suggestion, or response to the suggestion, that we do, that they come back, we might as well use this committee as any other, because we're asking questions about it, to pick up all those things that have been said about the strategy, what you're doing, where you're going, and some of these particular, the roadmap, if you like, and where those start aggregating up those savings and the benefits. The individual business cases will, of course, go to policy and resources, but I think the outline of the strategy and what business cases are going to fall off that, and any that's currently ongoing, any programmes or projects ongoing, and update that, because we can burn through a lot of money very quickly on IT projects, you know, and they can be delayed. So, if are we okay with that? If you want to have a word with Phil and talk through what we're doing in terms of management and business information, in terms of the particular system you're going forward with, which I think is a good system, actually, and links to your 361, Stuart, so you'll be pleased to. Okay. Would you all like to move on, colleagues? Yeah. Okay. Right, it's a real IT night tonight, isn't it? So, smart business project. Update. Again, this is down to Nikki. Are you two doing this between you again as well? You're both nodding in synchronisation too. I'm very impressed. So, who's taking us through what?
I'll take us through the report. If I may, I'm going to ask if we can be joined by the project officer, and Dixon will be able to provide any specific answers to any technical questions this evening.
Okay, of course you can. And while he's coming forward, again, this was something around Phil, the point that Phil had mentioned, and I think something about the general frustration with this committee around the council. But a lot of our business information, in terms of finance, how we're doing, how we're performing, and so on, is normally, by the time it's been around the block, or the show, it seems to be, you know, a couple of months out of date. But it will all be okay, I get told, because we're going to have our CRM system and everything's going to be fantastic. of set forms around all of this. So, would you like to say who you are and just let the committee know what you do and all that sort of stuff?
So, my name's Andy Dixon, project officer in the PMO project team, mainly on the digital project.
A project officer, that's not a project manager.
Well, it is.
Is this just a grading thing people call funny names? Is that right?
I'll be responsible for the implementation of the smart business project.
This report provides some information in respect of the ERP, the Enterprise Resource Planning Replacement Project, which is smart business. The smart business approach standardises and streamlines procedures and approaches to the administration of several key business activities, and will replace the council's current ERP system, which Council Gilchrist has just realisation from in terms of extracting financial information from some of the challenges that provides. 3.0 in the report provides background information and progress to date as we work towards go live from quarter two of 2021, and various phases leading to implementation are set out in 3.6 in diagram one for committee. Over on diagram two, we provide project governance arrangements. Just for committee's information, the programme board is pending review at the digital level, as are all programme boards currently at the request of the chief executive. So there's one SRO name twice in a row, and that will be reviewed. In terms of the outline business case, we provided a draft outline business case as exempt at this time. This is to provide the committee with further concepts and information in relation to the direction that we are going with the ERP replacement. And we're happy to take any questions.
I'll make an observation, right? I'm sure the chief executive has mentioned this. We did one of these for the IT one of these for the chief executive. They are incredibly complicated and difficult. Yeah, there is one thing a business has to do, and that's pay its staff. This is about pay, isn't it? It's finance, procurement, payroll, HR, all that sort of stuff. This is massive, and if you get this wrong, and if you don't do the data transform, it can be an absolute disaster. So this needs, the people who are doing the project need the support, need to know that they are supported, but they also, because there will be lots of areas that don't want to do it that way. Finance have always done it a particular way, they're not changing, etc., etc. So there will be doors that need to be knocked down for you, but also it is absolutely critical in terms of what could go wrong and how much this could end up costing. So again, what I'm not seeing here is any oversight, critical oversight, or anything outside the officer, bubble that is overseeing what's being done here. Because this has the potential to absolutely decimate our reputations with the people we serve and the people who work for us and the people who buy stuff from us or we buy stuff from them. So this is massive. I mean, do you think the business has an understanding of how big this is?
In terms of engagement with the business to date, Andy will be able to provide you with an overview of where you're up to with that. I think it would be just one to recognise that we too do recognise that the level of complexity in this project is probably above anything from an IT perspective that we've taken on. Certainly in the last 10 years. So we would welcome the committee's oversight and along with the digital transformation programme sitting within whichever is the development committee. We may see through discussion with the associate that we need to bring something separate on this particular project through a different arrangement just so there is a higher level of assurance and oversight provided.
So in 3.7 and 3.8 explains about the background work that's gone in so far, which is the two-phase stakeholder, and that takes us to the discovery phase, which also included benchmarking with other local authorities and soft market testing. So we got in different vendors to show us the different solutions that they had, so that we could get agreement from each line of business to see which one suits us best, which then takes us into the design phase, which we're working on currently. And we're working with each line of business to build a statement of requirements. That's what we're up to today.
Stuart.
Thanks, Chair. A couple of questions. You mentioned you have motor sites and you'd have to maybe look at some specific vehicle for that. We'd be very interested in what that might look like. Also, you mentioned the discovery phase is complete. So, I'm assuming the discovery phase is where you talk to the various areas of the business, and then they take that's what we want out, and what we want out of the system, more of you. So, what's given the budget? Was the budget set with the overall spend on the system? Was that set prior to the discovery phase, or was it being set after the discovery phase? Because, in my experience, you know, when you aggregate all the wants, it becomes unaffordable, and then you have to start repairing back. Basically, what the system can offer.
In terms of the calculation for what the proposed budget to deliver this project is, an assessment was made across from a research perspective into similar size organisations as to what they are. They have paid for implementation, are paid by way of licensing, etc. So it's based on that calculation. Clearly, we don't know the exact figure today. That's part of the work that we're doing, and obviously the soft market testing will help us to inform part of that. But that is essentially the calculation. In terms of how the government moves forward with a political interface, I'd be keen to work with Steve Fox and others from the CS team to how this can be brought into the committee system and relevant to this committee.
Yeah, of course, you.
Thanks, Jim. I think we know where the cost starts and amounts up is when vendors start to build interfaces in order to or customise what their existing offers are in order to carry out our wish really, because I think there's a fine balance in this. The system's got to do what we need and what makes life easier for the people on the ground. But we've also got ground in terms of cost and finances. Otherwise, it's just going to, the cost of just going to scale out of control.
So, have we put together a business case for the chef?
Yeah, sure. So, there was a strategic outline case written 6 months ago. We've just moved into.
Can I ask who approved the strategic outline? Where did it come to? Who discussed it? Who approved it?
That was presented as part of the council.
Business case or something.
The strategic outline case which set out and identified a council requirement.
So, go on, Chair. So you approved it?
Yes.
So
full council approved the estimate of the funding in the capital budget, but full council didn't have to do the outline case. So the outline case was approved by officers, but council had approved an indicative figure in the capital programme. The reason we did that was we needed to take an assessment of what the revenue cost could be going forward. So that's why that's in, as Tim says, that figure will change as we go further down the line.
Okay. I would hope, because Stuart is asking absolutely spot on questions, I would hope that rather than the line in the capital programme that we've said that seems sensible, there will be this opportunity that we've talked about to actually look at the business case me, there are key things here around data migration, around change management, so the senior users shouldn't just be saying, this is how we do it now, this is how we like to carry on doing it, please. You know what I mean? It should be some of those working practices that we currently have should be challenged from that. So it's all that sort of reassurance that I want. And picking up Stuart's point, my understanding at the end of the discovery phase, we should actually be moving to, if we're doing this in an agile way, which is discovery, we should be pretty close to a prototype at the end of a discovery phase, shouldn't we? In proper agile project management approach.
Yeah, in terms of this project, what we will end up with is a statement of requirements that will then inform the tender.
Did we kind of agree amongst ourselves that we would like to see a bit of a business case around this, given that it is so key to what, and I would imagine why we're around the council. Ian, sorry, you want to say?
Picking up on the theme really we've had so far tonight, on the internal audit report that's attached to this report, it's dated August 2018, and Mark, I think you were the person who authorised that report. And some of the findings in the internal audit report are the language in that report is pretty shocking. I think certainly for council report, it's not something that I'm familiar with seeing council reports where all the lines and everything's wonderful. But if you look at 1.3 on page 45, we conclude that the system is not fit for purpose and consideration should be given to replacing it or upgrading it. Fine. 1.2, in our opinion, the system is outdated and unable to provide services as expected, and we're not compliant with basically the GDPR, as data can't be deleted, or if we can't be sure that it's accurate. And then when we look at the main concerns with the current system of 1.6, inability to raise electronic invoices, well that was brought up at the last meeting that we had here, budget managers are unable to run their own reports, which possibly explains why we take to go a bit airy in some departments, and most crucially, we're not compliant with legislation. Now this was from August 2018, again, we've now got sight of this internal audit report, so really what's been happening since August 2018 to deal with those issues. And then on point 5.1, the consultant that was employed, PTG Consulting Limited, their contract ends this month, so what's happening after this month? Are the contractor that has that contract been extended? Are we satisfied that their work on this is helping us deal with those issues, or what's happening?
I could certainly provide you with details of the status of the recommendations that are identified in the report. I do put that in a report that I'm going to create a report that I'm going to present to you later on the agenda. But basically, there is progress being made, and I do report that. There is still work to do, clearly, but the findings from the recommendations that were made were of the three recommendations, two of them have now actually been implemented. One that is focused on progress that relates to the business case the chair referred to earlier. The actual recommendations that have been implemented on are related to the finding of the risks of the report being taken into consideration when deciding on whether to upgrade the current version of software or replace it, and cost benefit analysis being conducted followed by a feasibility study, which we're hearing from the guys that is very much so. I'm giving that a kind of, a progress is being made at this stage, but there's more work to be done in terms of the summary.
Just on points regarding the consultants that were employed 18 months ago. I'm
not too sure, I can't answer that. So, PDG's support of one business has just been renewed from 30 years.
Tendered again, or was it one of these continuations? Yeah, go on.
So I think what we mean is the extension.
Well, speaking to one of the.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so the extension was granted through an exception request because that's a single source provider who can provide this service.
So we didn't re-tender it then?
No. This is part because, and I'm sure this will be confirmed, but the support on our existing system doesn't really exist because we're on quite an old version. So the amount of providers available to us...
Mark said it's all okay now, really. He said it was pretty bad.
Yeah,
sure. I'm really upset. I know. I'm really upset. But yeah.
Exactly.
Well, I tell you what then. Just because I have a real concern about consultants that come in, they might be very expert, but because they've got all that background knowledge, which is our knowledge that they've taken from us, by the way, and then they are seen as the only people who can carry on giving that expertise. There should be, rather than just continuing, there should actually be some sort of competitive process that asks them to look at their fees and charges. So, maybe if you can come and speak to Ian about this particular case, I'm sure the lawyers are getting a bit twitchy, but speak to us about the individual case, how that was tendered, to ensure that we got the full value for money. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
Stuart?
But we just said about that information from the local court committee.
Yes, of course. Of course. Of course. Yeah. We believe in transparency. Just to let you know, you've been looking after in charge of all this for some time. Okay, so thank you for that. I think we've got broadly clarity around that. We're going to put together the business case. You're putting together the business case. We're going to, because of its the nature about what it impacts, you're going to come back to us with a report around all that and about how we're going to manage the assurance around it to give us some sense of that. I mean, no doubt it'll go to Cllr at some point. Kathy?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, I asked her at a previous meeting, and she very kindly advised me she couldn't give me the information because of the amount of manpower, which was the no PO, no pay. So I asked how many invoices have been paid, that purchase order number, which means the 6 months since there had been a no PO, no pay system. And once that, when that had been in place in the 6 months between April and September, it was something like just under £30 million. Now, I'd asked her the previous year, the previous financial year, 2018-2019, girls concerned that if, when there was a system in place, we'd given out or paid out invoices for 30 million without a PO number, how many did we pay out in the previous financial year when we didn't have a system? And unfortunately, she was very honest and said it would be so time consuming that it would be impossible to do. Now, assuming that the information that Ian has just spoken about, or the system at the moment is shit, to put it in broad terms, this new system, when it comes in, will that be able to pinpoint the information that I requested that you couldn't provide, will this be able to do it? Because the bottom line is that if we can't control the Wirral Council's finances because the computer system is that bad, that you press a button and the report comes out, it could be accurate, it could not be, it probably isn't, then you're never ever going to get the budget set where you're within budget, because nobody knows what anybody's doing, who's being paid what. And so the acid test is, and whatever the cost is, I'm sure it'll be a lot of money, but there comes a point where, on cost benefit, will Council cease to exist and be a proper functioning body if it doesn't have a computer system that's fit for purpose. And so the bottom line is that all the information that you require to do your job and you require to scrutinise will be satisfied by your computer system. And so what I would like to know is that if I asked you in a year or 2 years time, 2022, whenever the system will become live, that if I asked you the same information that you could give that to me, that that would be possible with this new system.
Who is going to take the brave step to say yes? Because Cher would like to say yes, but I can see the alley to go come in with a more nuanced response.
Yes, yes. So, my fast forward reporting is listed as one of the key requirements. It's an essential requirement of the new system.
So, what financial year could I ask to share that information? And actually, if the information is all transferred over to the new system, would you retrospectively be able to give you that information, or does that become default? That it's just, it's gone, it can never be retrieved. Do you see what I mean?
That will all depend on the data migration, that would be agreed at the project board, what's coming across and what data are we going to bring across. There's another piece of work that goes before we implement called ERP readiness, and that is there's four work streams for that. That means we get our house in order in terms of process and data management, so we get it as clean as we can before we move across to the new system, and that's when we'll do a full data plan the data comes across. So yes, let's just like to be
yeah, cool.
That's right. Because I can't provide the information now without trawling through a manual process, I don't think we'll be able to provide that information without doing some sort of that manual data cleansing process. So going forward, you'll be able to find anything as if you'd be required. As Andy says, there will be some from now, for example, the data that we have now, we're developing our system within our current system, that the data will be better, that we can get out, so we don't be in okay. Keith will talk about this later. The reports that we are writing and providing are giving us more information from now onwards. So from now, I'd be definitely confident to say from April 2020, anything that we do, we can import, migrate into the new system, we can provide that retrospectively. I would say anything pre-April 2020, I would not be confident to say that we can give you all that information without a degree, this same degree of manual data cleansing.
You want to?
Yep. Just to this doesn't seem I prefer. I think
Yes. Another, you're not spot, because either I see you listening. Okay. All right. Okay.
No.
Sorry, Jim. Yeah.
Is there a projected timeline for when will this come online? When will and who will be able to access it? Is there a level where you can access it, just so you have to go through a committee stage, so who can access it and when?
And I think that's what this early report, because you, according to your timeline, you've finished the, quarter three, yeah, so you'll finish the discovery phase. So you should be in a position to draw that together for the business case. You've already allocated capital for it. So, we should be able to get a presentation around the business case, how it's going to work, when it's going to be delivered, how much it's going to cost, etc. Now, my understanding is you're in a procurement process around this at the moment, but you can see there's a lot of interest and a lot of support in terms of what it is that you want to do. So, okay, people content with that? Yeah, sorry.
If that data exists, at what level can you actually access it? Is there a procedure for stuff you can access it? Is it at an officer level, a member level? So if you want information, you want to tap something in.
Oh, right.
So where does that flow to? And who to?
So in terms of the requirements of individual elements of the business, chief officers and members, that will form part of our analysis as to what the system needs to deliver. In terms of the specific information that's drilled down in there, it'll be around engagement with those who share as to what can be in the public domain and what can't. So it'll be through that process.
I think if we put the data and it's online and senior officers can get the data and that data is then reported to whichever committees that we need to report, and we already have a system where anything of £500 or more is publicly on the council's internet for public to see, why would we not that information is readily available to the public throughout the year. Why would we not do that?
Well, Andy's not in effect because he's quite excited by the idea.
So, I'm sorry, some councils who have got the next generation ERPs to be published from the data, but that's a policy decision.
So, to be clear, then, with the new system, that would need to seek new policy resources to set that policy.
Yes, absolutely. I'm in favour of that being transparent as well, because we don't publish anything that puts the council at risk, then I don't see why we can't publish it anyway.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, great stuff. Well, I'll be glad we put this on the agenda now. Who thought? Who would have thought it? Right, okay. So, you're okay with getting your submissions? Oh, sorry. Sorry. You're okay in terms of putting that together. That's been drawn together. Super, thank you. So next item on this one is a bit of a change of gear now, and we're into minimum revenue provision. Sorry, can I thank you for your presentation? They're really helpful and useful, so thank you for that. Appreciate it. So, who's going to talk about the minimum revenue provision reprofile? Have you heard of you, that chair?
I'm actually Pete Mullen, to come.
Oh, right, okay.
And present that
for you didn't want to be. Okay.
Good evening, Chair, good evening, members. This report went to Cabinet on the 20th of November 2019. It's a very technical area, I'm afraid. Of course, the accountants are lie down in dark and winter, but it's time to sort some of the issues. So, I'll do the best to keep it simple. Okay. So, the council had an opportunity to reprofile the MRP, and that's what they're able to make some budget reductions in the coming years. I thought about what budgets. Perhaps we can explain what MRP is. Whenever council borrows money for capital projects, it must pay them back. Now, sometimes it's back from the loans of what we call maturity loans, so you might take out over 20 years and the loans will be back in 20 years' time. But you're not allowed to just account for that repayment in 20 years' time. There must be a charge each year to reflect these assets, etc., and build up a provision, so you can pay back the debt. There's been lots of changes in those regulations allowing us to do that. Up to 2003, it was kind of very much a venture fixed formula. Happy to have it done, it's based upon 4% of the kind of capital loan, etc., to pay it back. From 2003 onwards, with a change in system from a borrowing system to a credit approval system to a borrowing system, and new regulations came up from the DCHE, which gave more flexibility. Okay. The Cabinet Report of the Cabinet explained then, since then, there was some consultants for some of the regulations, and the very complex adjustment called the Adjustment A, which is around the change of system. Allows you to kind of set a starting point at a particular point. The higher the interest rate figure, the lower the actual initial charge would be, and the spread would be longer, etc. So the consultants came in and identified a number of items that they put into a different item. What that does is actually lower the initial charge period, or charge in the early years. You're still paying for that back over a long period, but you get an efficiency. £23 in the first 10 years by doing this, and that just allows us to have money area in our budget, so reduce charge in our budget and build in later years. So you're still paying for my back, just to be correct for hand. So if you know that, that's quite complex thing to do. But basically, would you want to pay your loan back in small amounts or bigger amounts? Okay. It's about provision, it's about making charge to make provision. You have to be intended for making interest, etc. It should put some money into the pot so that when the loans are repaid, you use the kind of concept.
Okay, thanks, Pete. I'm sure there's going to be lots of questions. I would just point out, because you make it sound very benevolent and very reasonable, not a good thing to do. But I do recall that apparently the council wanted to take all 26 million in one bite and bang it into our accounts. And I think it was the external auditors that said they thought that would be an appropriate way of utilising that particular benevolent set of circumstances that you've identified. So that right? So, I think, go on, yeah, please.
Yes, that's right, and you'll see from the audit finance report and the audit and the audit letter that we discussed the treatment going forward and we're satisfied that it does meet the latest requirements and it's a prudent approach to take. We've seen it happening quite a bit. The authorities have looked at the MRP in particular as a way of making the revenue savings going forward.
Thank you. And there was so much backwards and forwards in on this, and we, sorry. We're now clear, are we, that this 2.6 million, not the 26 million, but the 2.6 million over 10 years, will be fed into the council's funds that can then be either spent on stuff or used to reduce the council tax, yes? So it's actually going into our revenue budget one way or another.
So what it does is it reduces future MRP charges. So for example, if you had a charge for next year under the old system, you say 5 million, the next year it'd be 2.4 million. Yeah. So that's the kind of the lower charge, they're looking more. You don't need to set aside much of your budget for MRP.
So, yeah, all I'm trying to get at is we're often told there's this big budget gap. Yeah, and we have to make cuts to fill the budget gap or whatever. But this is 2.6 million that we're going to get that reduces that gap from what we want to spend, including by making provisions and, you know, the services that we provide. So that's 2.6 million into that, to provide services or to reduce council tax. Is that correct?
Right? Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Lovely. Thank you. Phil?
Well, I remember it must be last summer, I think, when I was digging into the annual report of which accounts, I found that footnote in those pages and highlighted it to members. So I do understand it then, I really understand it now. I think I'm so long in the tooth that we still remember Merseyside County Council, and we've still got bits in Merseyside County Council debt